Presence tonight, Lord. And Lord God, we just thank you for your promises, Lord, as in your word that you declare that you came, the Father sent you here to heal us and to deliver us from our destruction. And as we learn tonight in that song, that it's the praises of your people, that's where you dwell. You always dwell in the praises of your people, and in your presence there is healing. In your presence, there is deliverance. In your presence, there is peace. So, Lord God, we thank you, Lord, for you are who you are. Because, Lord God, we all know, as your word declares, that anything that we do in the flesh cannot please you. And so you call us to worship you in spirit and in truth. So it's not on our shoulders, but it's what you did at Calvary that allows us to receive this gift. It's a free gift. We don't have to work for it. We don't have to earn it. As you have declared, as the Word of God also tells us that All good gifts comes from the Father of lights, that's your Father in heaven. And so anything that is good in your life, just know this, that it's a gift from God. And we all have needs in our lives. We need healing. We need deliverance. We need restoration. We need peace in our hearts. And these things, no matter what we do in the flesh. And just remember this, that Hebrews 10:13, it says that he tells us to persevere so that when you have done the will of God, you will receive what he has promised. So the key is this, no matter what you're going through, no matter how you feel, just look unto Jesus. It doesn't matter what we're going through. It doesn't matter what we think of ourselves. The truth is, if we hold steadfast in the Lord, his will be done. And we all know that his will is that none should perish, that all will be healed, delivered, and be set free from the captivity of the things of this world. It's the things of this world that brings us down, but Jesus came, for he is who he said he is, and what he said, like his word declares that whoever the Son sets free is free indeed, and what sets you free is the truth. And he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father but by me. So just focus on him, and your healing will come. And the thing is this, the healing is not just to get healed in your weak bodies. The healing that he brings is to make you whole, mind, body, soul, and spirit, so that your whole being will be praising him. And once again, as I sang in the song, it's our praises that brings his presence to us. So we just give him all glory and praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good evening, family. I just pray that you have your eyes turned upon Jesus. He is the Prince of Peace. He is our hope. He is our love. And he's full of mercy. Tonight is healing service, and I know that we've had different requests come in for people who need physical healing. But I want to begin with a praise report that is really awesome. I have some friends living up country now, and last night I went to bed shortly before midnight, I believe it was, and I had prayed for our church family, as I do in the evening before I fall asleep, pray for those we've ministered to, commit them to the Lord, and usually by midnight when I usually fall asleep, I'm really tired, and I'm a good sleeper. I thought I never snored, you know, because I can't hear myself snore. And one day I roomed with my mom and my sister in a hotel room, and we're talking about snoring, and I said, you know what, I'm so glad I don't snore, you two snore. And my sister laughed and she said, you snored the loudest. I said, I can't believe that, because usually when I kind of snort, I get up. And she said, no, you snore really loud. But I'm a good sleeper, and once my head hits the pillow, you know, I have a good night's rest. But last night, I went to sleep praying for everybody's safety and peace and all of that. And almost every 2 hours, I was getting up and I was praying for the area where my friends live. Later on this morning, I learned that there was a great big brush fire going in their direction. And some of them are new Christians, and I want you to know that this is why we need to be filled with the Holy Spirit. This is why we need to be in a body together, because when we're in danger, somebody across the world may have that burden to pray for us. I've had that happen to me. And people would pray not knowing that I was in danger and God would give me a miracle of deliverance. But God woke me up just about every 2 hours. In fact, I told one of my friends, you know, I don't know why I kept getting up every 2 hours and I was praying for that particular area. And then I found out that my friends lived there and they had been endangered, but God spared them. So when I say that, you know, we need to be filled with the Holy Spirit, that's what I mean. We're connected. And even if we don't know the danger, your brother or sister, or sometimes just God will send an angel himself to rescue. And one of these nights, maybe I'll have somebody who will tell you how he was rescued from windsurfing before he became a Christian. And God sent an angel to rescue him, he realized later on. But tonight is our healing service. But I just wanted to thank God. And let's bow our heads in thanksgiving for his protection over that area. And I heard that there's a firebug. Somebody's lighting these fires. So let's pray that God will stop him. Our Heavenly Father, once again, we're so quick to ask you for protection and peace and all these wonderful things. But sometimes we're just friends for sparing them and their property. I pray for peace, Lord. You're speaking to us. Devils are restless. Their time is short. And unless we're under the blood of Jesus, we're not under your protection. So I have to pray, and we thank you for sparing them, for joy for them. I pray that their hearts will be filled with thanksgiving to you, who know everything and love us so much. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Tonight is our healing service. And I was reading an article from Johns Hopkins Medical Center about forgiveness, because forgiveness is the heart of the Christian faith. There's so many things connected to forgiveness. And of course, we know that it is only the forgiveness that God gives to us through the sacrifice of his son. As long as I'm good, you know, I'm going to make it. Well, who is the judge? Who's the gift of God, not of works, lest because we are forgiven. And in order to be forgiven, we need to humble. And we are all sinners. But Jesus, God in the flesh, came to take the punishment for our sins so that we can be forgiven. And tonight we're going to learn that we can be healed. The report from Johns Hopkins Medical School about forgiveness, first of all, is that forgiveness is a choice, okay? God chose to forgive us. We can choose to receive it. And that reminds me of an incident, maybe happened about 2 years ago now, but there was a policewoman in Dallas who had done a double shift, I think, and was very tired late at night going home. And she lived in a condominium, and she parked her car and went to what she thought was her own apartment. But what she didn't know was that she had parked on a different floor. And so she got off her car and went toward what she thought was her apartment. The door was slightly ajar for a reason. She pushed herself in. And there sat a black man, and she instinctively drew her gun and shot him to death because she thought he was an intruder. It was a very tragic situation because this innocent man was killed because this policewoman had made a mistake. About a year later, when she, of course, had been arrested and she was going to be sentenced in the courtroom, they asked for, you know, victim statements and so forth. And so different ones said different things. But there was an 18-year-old brother of the man that had been killed. And that man that had been killed, and we don't understand this, he was like a praise and worship leader in the church. So why would this happen? We don't understand it. Except that perhaps the testimony of what happened through his brother is resounding in the heavens around the world and in our nation today, I hope, where there's so much hate between civilians and policemen, between whites and blacks. This man was black, the policewoman was white. And perhaps God put him on the 18-year-old brother. to the police. Wish is not for you to go to jail. She was given a 10-year sentence, but for you. And the whole courtroom was stunned. The policing the woman who shot his brother to death. And you know, unfortunately, the world is crazy because there are some critics of his act. But on his mother's Facebook, the mother wrote, his name is Brant John. Brant, I am so proud of you. It doesn't matter what your critics say. It doesn't even matter what the forgiven does with the forgiveness that you gave. You did the right thing, and I'm proud of you. And because of what that 18-year-old did, we remember the legacy of his brother who seemed to have died in vain, because it's a wonderful lesson for our whole nation now that is rioting and fighting and hating, that forgiveness is the cure. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to God's purpose. So forgiveness is a gift you give to yourself when you have a right to be angry or hurt or bitter against somebody who will not let you go. And John Hopkins University Medical School says, anger puts you in a fight or flight mode, which results in numerous changes in your body. Your heart rate changes, your blood pressure changes, and your immune response system is affected. That means unforgiveness and anger can make you sick physically. This is why the Lord, whose word is medicine to us, tells us how to be healed. Some of you are sick. And while we're going through this, these scriptures, I want you to let the Holy Spirit deal with this issue tonight. Do you have unforgiveness in your heart? Because the results of it, it says that it increases depression, it increases heart disease, it increases diabetes and other conditions. Cancer can be caused by it. Arthritis and ulcers have been proven to be linked to anger and unforgiveness. In tonight's scripture, I want you to turn to Isaiah 53, verses 3 to 6. If you ever hear me praying for healing, I use a scripture from this punishment for our sins and also bring wholeness to our body, healing to our body. Isaiah 53, verses 3 to 6 says this: He, Jesus, is despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we did not esteem him. Have you ever felt despised by somebody? Well, Jesus knows how he feels, and he will work on your behalf because he knows how much that hurts. He was despised, and it says, we did not esteem him. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yes, we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. And this is a scripture I use many times. But he was wounded, not for himself. He was wounded for our transgressions when we break the law. He was bruised for our iniquity, our rebelliousness against God. The chastisement for our peace, the punishment he took was to give us peace. It was upon him. And by his stripes, and they say by Roman crucifixion, they whipped the criminal 39 times. The law allowed 40 whips, they say, but they would only do 39 times because it was so severe, and they said just in case they miscounted, they did not want to give the criminal an extra one. So 39 stripes, and I read a medical book written by a Jewish doctor who says there are 39 major diseases in the world. Every disease is linked to these 39 major diseases. And he says by his stripes that he bore when he went to the cross, if you've ever seen the movie The Passion, you saw them whipping him. He already paid for your healing. I want you to understand that. He's paid for your healing. In God's grace and mercy, he says all we have to do is to receive it, to believe. You know, what do we have to lose? You know? He said, just believe. He says, all we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. And of course, in our Lord's Prayer found in Matthew chapter 6, when Jesus was asked, you know, by his disciples, teach us how to pray, because they didn't feel like they knew how to pray. Jesus said, Matthew 6, verse 9, in this manner, therefore, pray, he says, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be your name, holy is your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Yes, every day he's going to provide for us. And forgive us our debts or our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. For if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive you your trespasses. So, if you want to go to heaven, and there are only two places, there's a Father waiting for you. He has forgiven you if you receive that forgiveness. And he says, you forgive those who have trespassed against you. So it's conditional. We don't just say the sinner's prayer and feel like we can go to heaven. He says, no, as now I have forgiven you, as you forgive those who have trespassed against you, you get to go to heaven. Now, we know we need the Holy Spirit to help us do that, because none of us in our flesh can forgive somebody that we have some kind of ought against, you know? So we need the Holy Spirit to do that. And he has a procedure, and I'd like for you to turn to Romans chapter 12, verse 2. He says this. Do not conform to the pattern of the world. Don't be like the worldly people who do not have the life of Jesus in them. If you're not full of Jesus, if you're not full of the Holy Spirit, you know who you're full of, because there are only two kinds of spirits roaming around in this earth. And if you want safety, you need to be in the shadow of the Almighty. You need to choose. You can choose peace. You can choose protection. God is fair. He gives you the choice, and so you are where you are in life by the choices you've made. And he says, do not be pressed into the pattern of the world, but be changed, transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good and pleasing and perfect will. So if we want to really forgive, then we need to get full of God's word, so that we, our mind that has been full of the devil before we became born again, and we did almost automatically the devilish, hateful things, because we've got a new nature. That new nature is fueled and nourished by the Word of God. So he says, renew your mind. In normal words, I would have to say it's like change your diet. You know, when we're young, we eat all kinds of stuff, all kind of rubbish, and we don't feel sick until we hit middle age, and then we have this pain and that pain and whatever, and then we get some disease, and they want to, you know, healthily fit person you were before you're born again, then you need to change your diet. And now your diet is not the movies you see, the books you read, the conversation of friends that are not really speaking things that are good. You no longer want the diet, and you want to renew your mind by the Word of God. And in closing, I'd like for you to turn to Galatians chapter 6, because you see, when we get born again and receive the blood of Jesus and we receive Holy Communion, our sins are under the blood. We can claim divine healing for our diseases, claim it and thank God for it. But then today, tonight, you can plant seeds for better health in your future. I don't know how old you are, you know, but the change for the better is always good, no matter how old you are. And in Galatians, it tells us how we can plant good seeds. It says in the 7th verse, do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever a man sows, that will he also reap. Okay? I'm not a gardener. I'm a poor gardener. I try, but my plants die. But I know enough that if you plant carrot seeds, you're going to get carrots. You're not going to get cucumbers. I know that much, okay? And so this is what it says. You choose the seeds you want to plant. It says, because whatever seed you plant, that's what you're going to reap. So if you change your physical diet and you eat more fruits and vegetables and less, you know, processed foods and sugars and white rice and all those good stuff that we shouldn't eat, if you choose to do that, you're going to reap good health. And spiritually so. If you learn to get the poison of anger and unforgiveness out of your system, our body is chemically made, as the John Hopkins report says, it changes our chemistry when we are angry. You remember when we get angry? You know, after that, after you have a good fight, you're exhausted, you know, because the enzymes or whatever gets really hyper and gets overworked, and this is why we scream and yell and do all of this. And after that, we're tired. Sometimes it leads to depression, okay? But the Lord says, do not be deceived. God is not mocked. He's that. You're going to only reap what you sow. So be smart. And even when somebody sows bad seed to you, cancel out the bad things that they say, by obeying. But he who sows to the Spirit, that means if you obey the Holy Spirit, of the Spirit, you will reap everlasting life. You can reap either everlasting life or everlasting death. Then it encourages us and says, let us not grow weary in doing good, for in due season you shall reap if you do not lose heart. And this is the scripture for me, because I need to know to exercise more. I am really bad about exercising, but I do know if I exercise, I do feel better. I will stay healthy. But sometimes I get weary in doing the exercise, and then I don't feel so lively and good. So what we sow, we're going to reap. Therefore, it says, as you have opportunity for your own sake, no matter how the other person is, it says, let us do good to all, especially to those who are of the household of faith. And those of you who are members of our church know that that's what I ask you to practice. We help our church, you help your own family first. And then you help the church family. And as our church family grows, we got talents and needs all together mixed up, and we help each other. So I'm going to pray that if you're struggling with unforgiveness, that God will release you now, that I'm going to give you some scriptures, because some of you asked for scriptures on different subjects. But let's pray for healing. Holy Spirit, I pray in Jesus' name that wherever people are, do the searching. Let them not live in condemnation and guilt if their sins have been forgiven. But Lord, if there's some hidden sin, a hidden anger, hidden unforgiveness, through your love and mercy, reveal it now so those who come under the conviction that you give will quickly repent of it and say, Jesus, please forgive me. Clean out my closet that I've hidden all of these things. By your precious blood, make me willing to be willing to forgive, because it's so hard for me. But I give this to you. I don't want to be sick. I don't want to die young. I want to be under your protection. And most of all, I want to go to heaven and not hell. So Lord, hear their prayers. Each one is making a decision tonight whether they're going to obey you or not. Now heal our bodies. Everybody, wherever you are, wherever part of your body is hurting, put your hand on it and receive healing. I command the healing power that comes from the sacrifice of Jesus on the cross to touch you from the crown of your head to the soles of your feet. Every organ, every muscle, every cell, every tissue, every nerve, every bone, every joint, every organ, be healed by the blood of Jesus and the stripes that he bore. Be healed. Receive it. In Jesus' name, I command your body to line up with God's word, which says, Beloved, I wish above all things that you prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospers. So let our soul be connected to you. Refresh us and give us health in every part. You said signs and wonders will follow. And we give you thanks in advance for the testimonies we will hear of people being healed right now, wherever they are. And especially, Lord, of that tormenting illness of unforgiveness and anger. Heal them of that in Jesus' name, and let love and peace flow in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, just clap your hands and praise Jesus. Raise your hands and say, thank you, Jesus. In faith, even before the evidence of that healing, your faith says, I am healed. So start celebrating. Amen. That's how I get healed. I celebrate before I feel I'm healed. And that is what pleases the Lord. So in closing, let me give you the 10 scriptures on forgiveness that will help you get your mind and spirit clean so you don't have these spiritual diseases that releases poison to your physical bodies, that your body will get healed as you obey God's word. Number one, Colossians 3:13. Colossians 3:13. Number two, Isaiah 43:25-26. Isaiah 43:25-26. Number three, Matthew 6:14-15. Matthew 6:14-15. These are like medicine to you. God's word is like medicine to our flesh and our bones, the Bible says. Number four, 1 John 1:9. 1 John 1:9. Number five, Acts 3:19. Acts 3:19. Number six, Daniel 9:9. Number 7, Isaiah 1:18. Isaiah 1:18. Number 8, Luke 17:3-4. Luke 17:3-4. Number 9, Psalm 103:12. Psalm 103:12. And the last, Ephesians 4:31-32. Ephesians 4:31-32. I think my mom's favorite verses for us kids: be kind one to another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another as Christ has forgiven you. So may God bless you. Be healed. Practice this tonight. Meditate on one or two of these scriptures. And sleep is made for us to be healed. Did you know that's why we go to sleep? It's to heal and repair all of ourselves. That's why we need good sleep. So meditate on this and be healed in Jesus' name. I love you, and I bless you in the name of Jesus, and I pray tomorrow you'll feel better than you did tonight. Amen. Meditate on God's word, and we will see the ladies tomorrow night. God's blessings with you. Aloha.